Funding for Election 2020 coverage is provided in part by AARP, a nonprofit, nonpartisan membership association, 86,000 strong in North Dakota. AARP encourages you to vote absentee or vote safely in person and make your voice heard. And by the members of Prairie Public.
Welcome to Prairie Public and AARP North Dakota's coverage of Election 2020. I'm Matt Olean. Tonight, the debate between the candidates for North Dakota's lone congressional seat. My guests tonight are Democrat Zach Racknerud, Libertarian Stephen Peterson, and Republican Representative Kelly Armstrong. Each candidate will have a one-minute opening and one-minute closing statement. In between, there'll be debate topics selected by myself. As you can see, we have socially distanced podiums to comply with safety measures for the ongoing COVID pandemic. And each candidate drew a number out of a hat, and based on that drawing, Stephen Peterson goes first on your one-minute opening statement.
I appreciate that very much. Thank you for inviting me here today. Thank you for attending this, Kelly. Thank you, Zach, also for being here. My name is Stephen Peterson. I am your Libertarian candidate for 2020. Rather than doing a long introduction, I would like to at least express that as a Libertarian this time, I'm coming here as the centrist between the two parties, hence the reason why I asked for the center here. So if I can, I would like to at least bring a consensus agreement to certain things here when we have these conversations, and that we maintain it as such. And outside of that, I hope that the people in North Dakota see who that they want to be our next congressman. And that's it for me.
Okay, Zach Racknerud, one-minute opening statement.
So I'm Zach Racknerud. I'm a lifelong North Dakotan, working class. I love this state. I love my country. I entered this race in January because I looked out across our government and the economy for the better part of 50 years and see what I refer to as a reverse funnel economy. Trillions of dollars in wealth is pouring to the very top of the economy into the hands of very few, while the bottom lines of our working and middle class families continues to erode day after day, year after year, decade after decade. The cost of healthcare, the cost of education, the cost of childcare, the cost of housing, all these basic tenets in life, their costs are rising unsustainably for our working families. So I entered this race to bring solutions to that in a way that Congress can invest in those tenets of life because the coronavirus pandemic has really made these issues clear.
Okay, Representative Armstrong, your one-minute opening statement. Well,
thanks to Prairie Public for hosting. Thanks, Matt, for moderating. Obviously, thanks to Zach and Stephen for being here. I think these things are really important as we go into an election cycle. Being able to talk to the voters in this format is absolutely critical for anybody who's running for office. And I'd be remiss if I didn't say thank you to my wife, Kirsty, and my son, Eli, and my daughter, Anna. Without their support, I couldn't do the job that the citizens in North Dakota have chosen me to do. And if I didn't know how hard it was to do what my wife does before, I know now, because she's been gone for 3 days on business, and it fascinates me how she can get done everything she gets done at home when I'm in D.C. We managed okay. We made a football practice. We made a soccer practice. We only missed one football practice by 24 hours. But why did I originally get into public service? Why am I asking to be reelected to Congress? Because of that. I want to be able to create a scenario where families in North Dakota from the western part of the state, eastern part of the state, all across this great state can continue to go forward and move forward.
Okay. All right. First topic. Let's get to it. Of course, it's COVID-19. Even though many people are back to work, schools are in session, some are in hybrid learning, some distance, the cases are still rising in many states, including our state of North Dakota, which unfortunately is making national headlines lately with rising cases. I want each of you to respond first on how the U.S. has responded to this crisis, President Trump specifically, and also within this state, and Governor Burgum and the state leader's response. Zach Racknerud, you go first.
On the response to the coronavirus, I would say from the president's level, it's been extremely poor. We've seen one $1,200 check stimulus come through and a paycheck protection program. Both of those things helped people, but to the scale that this crisis has undergone, it hasn't been adequate. We need to have more bold investments in our working families. We need to pass stimulus now because the numbers of the coronavirus pandemic and the economic foundation of our working people is struggling in a really big way. And so I've been extremely underwhelmed by the response. We can't be talking about withdrawing from stimulus talks right now. We need to talk about getting it done because the bottom lines of our working families are struggling in a big way.
Okay, Kelly Armstrong, your turn.
So I think the federal government did something very, very quickly that I don't think, I was a member of Congress, I don't think could get done, and that was with both CARES 1, CARES 2, and CARES 2.5, and getting those passed out with the PPP program. I think President Trump's institution of the travel ban on China early in this pandemic was incredibly important to stopping that. But you talked about North Dakota. Here's the deal. 48 out of 50 states in the last week have had increases in cases, and this isn't unique to the United States. You can talk about countries who thought they've done it well, countries who we've thought have done it poorly, and regardless, we are seeing this moving on across the state. There's a lot more work to do. We need to continue to do targeted, specific relief to extension of the PPP. And I think that's what's most frustrating about DC right now. There is broad bipartisan support to do an extension of PPP. There's broad bipartisan support to bail out the airlines. There's broad bipartisan support to bail out the restaurants. And because of the way and the things function right now, we just can't seem to get it done.
Stephen Peterson, your response.
I have a different opinion upon the presidential response to the beginning of the COVID-19 dilemma, that we had advanced knowledge in late December and early January that this outbreak had begun because we were getting information about the Chinese military digging and building berms that were 20 feet tall around the Wuhan province so that they didn't have to leave as many men at those locations with the idea that they would keep everyone locked down. Now, that was something to where we should have been able to see that, especially through congressional oversight, through intelligence committees, that should have been released in a more plain truth public address, that our president, as a proper commander-in-chief, should have told the people of the country, including North Dakota, what we were really looking at, what level of suck was about to come down the pipe. As far as additional stimulus at this time, I really would like to see the Problem Solvers Caucus and also to be able to see some of the bipartisan aspects of stimulus to come to fruition. However, we currently have a Speaker of the House that has gone rogue, and because of her activities, we currently are unable to see either side be able to pass through stimulus. If we're having a discussion between $1.6 and $2.2 trillion, what do we have to do to get that to where there's a consensus? That's my concern right now. Why do we have that brinksmanship here in Washington? And I would like to see our congressman, whoever the three it is, to be able to break that.
All right, Zach Racknerud, and kind of the follow-up of that as we continue is, within the state of North Dakota, some people you talk to think Governor Burgum has been too lax on the mask mandate. Others say it's been about right when things reopen. What is your response to within the state, how the state has handled this?
Yeah, I think North Dakota is unique in the sense that we're very frontier, we're very rural, and I've spoken to many folks across North Dakota who initially were very pleased with the response to the pandemic by Governor Burgum. But as time goes on and the virus has took hold here in North Dakota, we're starting to see a very different picture. Hospital capacities and staffing is extremely troubling right now as we go into the winter months. And we have to really consider a mask mandate in that sense, because when it comes to common spaces like the grocery store and the department store, and areas like that, folks should be able to go there and still feel safe from this droplet virus, and it would allow our private establishments to actually enforce the mandate itself without having to worry about competition from down the street retaliating or doing something different. So I would love to see taking this pandemic more seriously, especially as we get to the winter months here.
Okay, Kelly Armstrong, what are you seeing around the state?
Well, I think the best answer to this is always going to be local control. I would never ask North Dakota to shut down because there was a spike in New York City. I would never ask New York City to spike because there's a spike in North Dakota. And we've seen these debates play out in the Bismarck City Commission. We've seen them play out in the Fargo City Commission. And you have to meet people where you're at. And if you aren't willing to enforce, if you are going to put a mandate on from with the strength and power of government behind it, you better be willing to enforce it. And that's not just related with COVID. That's with any regulation, any criminal statute, any civil statute. To say you're going to do a mandate because it gives a business an opportunity to enforce that is an irresponsible way to purchase government, and you have to meet people. We need to wear a mask. We need to continue to do this. We need to continue to move forward. But if you can't get this passed through, whether it's a Fargo City Commission or a Burley County City Commission, I don't know how you're planning on doing a mandate without significant enforcement that is going to cause all kinds of problems. So there's a lot of ways to handle this. That isn't the only way.
Stephen Peterson, you get the last word on this topic.
Regarding Governor Doug Burgum and how he's been handling the lack of mandate here in the state of North Dakota, I greatly appreciate that he depends upon the responsibility of the individual voters to be responsible. That's how we should be as a government, regardless of which side of the aisle we come from. People need to understand that while they may not be comfortable with the mask requirements that we, at least out of common courtesy, should have amongst each other, that while you may not agree with it completely, at least out of courtesy for the others that are in our community, those that are immunosuppressed, that we ask you, please wear the mask, humor us for the meantime. This will pass in time, but we need to work together to make sure that we as people, without mandates, without law, can treat each other well and help keep each other healthy.
Okay, let's move on to the stimulus, which was mentioned. That's the current issue going on. Right now, talks are stalled as the two parties appear far apart. Where do each of you stand on this topic if elected to Congress? Kelly Armstrong, you start on this one.
Yeah, I was going to mention this. You said the difference is 1.6 between 2.2. It's not really. It's 1.5 with a $500 billion escalator, and that's what the Problem Solvers Caucus bill came out. I don't blame the president for calling off the talks, and I'll tell you why. The deal that's on the table now has been the same deal in D.C. for 2 months. I really appreciate my friends in the Problem Solvers Caucus on both sides of the aisle. I call a lot of them friends, but they didn't reinvent the wheel. This was the deal that was on the table, and here's the frustrating part. If Speaker Pelosi put it on the floor, it had passed the House and it had passed the Senate. And you know why? Because it's not quite what the Democrats want, and it may be a little more than somebody like me wants, but we're in a divided government with people hurting all across the country right now, and this is the kind of deal to get done. But this deal is in substance and frame the same deal that's been there for 6 weeks with no movement and not even a vote. And that's part of the makeup of the U.S. House. We can only participate in the fights we're invited to. And if you let this have a vote on the floor, it will pass with bipartisan support. And the president has said he would sign the deal. So then you get it over to the Senate. I don't know what's so hard about this. So I don't blame the president for saying, all right, let's go to standalone deals. Because this isn't, it's not like the negotiations didn't fall apart yesterday. They've never gone anywhere for 6 weeks at a time. So I think they need to continue to work forward. But I think the deal is pretty obvious what the deal should be.
Okay, Stephen Peterson, response.
I begrudgingly have to say that I completely agree with what Kelly just said, and I appreciate him correcting my numbers.
Zach and I will agree. We get to criminal justice, we'll all agree on some stuff here and there.
Outstanding. But one of the things that is holding up the House bill, and I'm a cannabis advocate, and there's a lot of cannabis pork that's been put into the bill, and I apologize to all the people that may come from that it followed me for a while. I do believe that there's improvement that we can make there. But right now, as Kelly just said, and as Zach has alluded to, people are suffering. We can put that to the side for a short period of time to make sure that people and the economy are able to move forward. And when we get to a position to where we have a better consensus and we're not being bound with trying to figure out how to feed people that are sleeping in their cars in the Southwest, then at that time, we can reintroduce that. But if that's part of the reason why the HEROES Act didn't move forward, well, then we need to stop with that brinkmanship. We need to help the people now. And we need to focus that, especially as was mentioned by both of these gentlemen here, targeted stimulus that goes to specific industrial sectors, especially the agricultural community here in North Dakota, because that is the heart of North Dakota. That's where the focus should be, not on the cannabis debate, not at this time.
Okay, Zach Racknerud, your turn.
Number one focus for me on stimulus right now is getting another stimulus check to the hands of the American people universally. I've spoken to many North Dakotans across the summer in events that are outdoors and socially distant. And the one that sticks with me the most is a woman from Washburn who is type 1 diabetic and battling breast cancer. And back in July, she told me she had about 3 months left of savings in order to pay for her insulin, in order to pay for her treatments. And after that, she was done. The American people are hurting and financially. We need to get a stimulus check out now. We can drop everything else and quickly get a stimulus done if that's what it takes. But when it comes to the rest of the relief, it's got to be focused on the places that it's needed most, particularly like things like hazard pay for our healthcare workers and essential workers, especially like teachers, whatever they're dealing with right now, which is just an incredible burden on them. And they're not being taken care of properly. Those are the kind of focuses that I would have in this relief package, but priority number one has to be getting that that cash to the American people, because there's so many folks right now who are late on rent, late on childcare, late on medical bills, everything across the board, and they're feeling hopeless. So Congress needs to come together and they should get this done before the election if possible.
Okay, Kelly Armstrong.
Yeah, I was just saying the president has, immediately offered, but the two things he offered as standalone bills were to bail out the airline industry, which is really important for everybody in this economy, and a standalone stimulus check. Those were the two offers that have been put out in the last 48 hours. We can't vote on it unless the leader of the U.S. House of Representatives allows us to do it, and it's that simple. And she flat out said that that is not going to happen. There was an airplane and airport bill last week that was on the floor that my colleagues blocked, which I thought was a little short-sighted. And now at the same time, the Speaker is saying we weren't going to take that vote. I know we're less than a month and away from an election, but that shouldn't matter for these things, especially when, whether it's the problem solvers thing, it's 25 Democrats, 25 Republicans. I said before, there are so many standalone things that we agree on. There's $150 billion sitting in a program that hasn't been used before that we put a discharge petition on the floor just to extend existing PPP. These are easy solutions, but we can't vote unless we're allowed to vote.
Okay, Stephen Peterson.
Building upon what Kelly Armstrong just said, that to be able to get a consensus reauthorization here in North Dakota and also from the feds so that, as was said earlier today during the state health briefing, that they can reallocate those funds from CARE Act 1, CARE Act 2, so that the state can address what are immediate concerns here. Now, I haven't been as close in communicating with the House members and the Senate members here in North Dakota, but I did watch the briefing today, and I'm very glad and happy to see that we have the Senate Majority Leader working so closely with the Senate Minority Leader, and the same with Mr. Boucher over in the House with Mr. Pollard. North Dakota is not the problem here. As a matter of fact, I really enjoy North Dakota politics because I think in other states we might be yelling at each other right now.
I miss North Dakota politics.
and we like having you around, you too. I'm not trying to take sides here. What I'm trying to say, though, is as he said, and as you have also said, that we need to get consensus down. We need to pass the bills. If we have to do part by part, piece by piece stimulus bills, that's over 30,000 airline employees that Kelly just referred to. That's a significant amount of people here in the United States. While that's not even close to the population of North Dakota, those people being able to pay their bills, being able to pay their insurance, being able to pay for food and rent, they matter too. Everybody requires help at this time. So thank you.
Zach Racknerud, last word on this topic.
The biggest thing that I would say with the criticisms of Speaker Pelosi is that I'm somebody who's not afraid to call Speaker Pelosi out. I'm very much on the record as saying that I don't think that she should be Speaker of the House. I would much rather see new generations of leadership in the Democratic Party, because there's a lot of economic pain out there in this country right now. The Democratic Party needs to reprioritize and focus on those kitchen table issues of the bottom lines of our working families. How much does their child care cost? How much does their rent cost? How much are they paying for health care? Those are the sorts of things that aren't on the radar of Congress as a whole, and it's really showing again in these stimulus talks and exactly where the priority of everyday members of Congress is going towards when it comes to crafting and messaging these bills. It's not in line with the working families of this country, and I'm happy to advocate for them.
Okay, last COVID topic going forward then. Until there's a vaccine, how would each of you govern this balancing act of keeping economies open, yet maintaining the safety of the citizens of North Dakota? Stephen Peterson, you start first on this one.
I think that we need to really look at our electorate, our voters, our citizens in North Dakota, and we need to speak to them with plain truth. And that's my only part that I'm going to give our commander-in-chief a hard time for, is that if he would provide consistent messaging across the board on how to deal with COVID-19, we can move forward. That'll help us deal with the fact that if there isn't a vaccine as quickly as they suppose, then in that aspect, again, it goes back to the individual responsibility, a very North Dakota thing, to where we don't wait for Washington to tell us what to do, but that we do what's right for our people here. While we do have an increase per capita on COVID-19 right now in the state of North Dakota, we also have to recognize that we're testing at a higher rate right now. Our 7% increase, while it is a climb, compared to Minnesota, where they were in the 20% climb for infections right now, I think that they'd be jealous of our slower rate that we have. We need to continue to educate the people of our state, give them the real information so that they can make their decisions on how they want to move forward. Give them the best information. Let them decide. Don't pass mandates.
Okay, Zach Racknerud, your response.
So my focus would be legislatively running for this U.S. House seat, and it really boils down to taking care of the well-being of our people a lot better. I worry greatly that the results of having to lock down and doing a lot of stuff when we didn't know much about this virus is having a toll on the mental health of our people in this country when it comes to our children or it comes to parents and everybody. I'm greatly concerned about what this economic and health crisis has done to our country. And my focus is going to be on ensuring that we put the priority on legislation that attacks those things, investments in mental health care, investments in the bottom lines of our working families. Those are things that they care about the most right now, because it's troubling to see exactly how many people are falling behind right now, and it's only going to get worse. The recovery is not happening at a pace that's going to bring the jobs back that we lost. And so we need to have a representative in government who's ready to advocate for the working class and to be the champion that really pushes the discussion of Congress in a different direction than it is right now.
Okay, Kelly Armstrong.
From D.C., I think we need to continue to work aggressively towards targeted relief that continues to move forward. We also need to recognize, which is something D.C. is always good at, is when we start talking about this stuff, we need to look at it through the lens of when this happened, whether it's relief on the PPP funding, whether it's any of those things. But we have to get that money to the states. We need to make sure that rural states, rural health care are appropriately taken care of. We've seen some things happen during COVID that we didn't know. I think when it started, we were worried about places like Killdeer or Hettinger as far as their healthcare facility. Well, with the programs we've already done, they have done pretty well. It's towns, it's communities like Grand Forks, communities like Dickinson, communities like Watford City and Williston that have really struggled. So we have to recognize that no matter how we come out of this, we have 8 months of a really weird incentive where we asked our healthcare providers not to do any electives in order to deal with this. So we have to make sure that we ensure their funding and their stability long term, because they're absolutely central bedrocks of every one of these communities across the country. So we need to continue, we need to push it forward, and then I also would say we need to get serious about making sure there's liability protection, or that will slow down the economic recovery.
Okay, I want to move to farm policy now. Can each of you comment on how the trade and tariff war with China has impacted North Dakota farmers and nationally as well? Zach Racknerud, you go first on this one.
Yeah, the trade war and the resulting legislation and action that was taken is very disheartening to me. When I look out and speak to so many of the small and medium sized farming operations in particular, it's important to note that the relief legislation that was signed executively was based on acreage. And what that meant was that the lion's share of that relief package went to the very large farming operations and not so much to our small and medium sized farms. I look out and I see corporate consolidation that's running rampant in the farming community. We have four main meat packers that process 80% plus of feedlot cattle in the United States. Six companies controlling over 60% of global proprietary seeds. Food conglomerates that are massive and have incredible bargaining power over our farmers are having an impact on their bottom lines. We need to attack these issues and increase the bargaining power of our farmers, because right now they're basically being told what they get to sell those things for, and they're not making a living. And the numbers when it comes to our family farms are extremely troubling. The average age of farmers climbing. Those who choose to continue to do it is also declining. It's something that we need to attack aggressively, because they've fed our nation and had us with a reliable food supply chain for decades, and I think that's something we take for granted. It's time that Congress works for them and actually does some tangible things that help their bottom lines.
Okay, Kelly Armstrong.
I think it's first important to start with USMCA, which is probably the most significant trade deal that's been done in a generation. There's a reason why all three of the Democratic members of the delegation voted against NAFTA at its origination. So we need to fully implement USMCA when the economy gets back going. It's important to recognize it's been bad in ag country for 5 years, and we know that, and we continue to see those suffering, and we continue to move forward. The MFP payments, as we were going through this process with China, were important, but farmers don't want payments, they want markets. At the same time, we have to continue to work for our bilateral deals with Brazil, with Britain, with Japan, and work forward. But I will tell you, I'm a small town kid who grew up in the oil gas industry and the ranching industry. I'm a free market guy. But I've learned a lot more about China since I've been in D.C., and it's not political rhetoric. It's things that guys with stars on their shoulders tell me. And we've seen, if there's one thing I think that's come out of this pandemic, it's more of a realization of the things China is doing at the economic level, at the technology level, at the intellectual property theft level. And we need to continue to hold them accountable moving forward. And that's before we talk into how the origination of the virus occurred or human rights violation on religious minorities. China's a serious threat. They're our number one geopolitical enemy, our adversary as we move into the 21st century. But also at the same time, they've been increasing their purchases of soybeans in the last 2 weeks, and they're the world's second largest economy. I still want to sell them our egg products, but we have to recognize that we are going to have to hold China accountable now and in the future.
Okay, Stephen Peterson.
I'm really glad that when I was reading the news today regarding ag here in the state of North Dakota, the Burlington Northern and Minot was finally able to get the intermodal transport station put together. 20 years of negotiations to make that happen. Now, that could have happened faster, sure. We can always second guess that. But that improvement right there is something that helps our farmers get product to market, regardless of size. So that way we're able to get things loaded up, get it onto the trains, get it out to the West Coast or the East Coast. Now, you mentioned about doing bilateral partnerships with Brazil. I honestly think that we need to perhaps take a look at that, because right now Brazil, before COVID-19 broke out, was trying to position themselves to where they would have knocked us out of the soybean market. And as you said, our farmers are seeking markets. That is fair. But again, China needs to be taken to task. The treatment of the Uyghur people in the northern China districts, where they're selling the hair off of those women, and that they're taking halal organs out of the children, supposedly. That's abhorrent. That's beyond even the things that we took surviving Nazis to The Hague for after World War II. We do need to address that. We do need to make sure that human rights violations are dealt with. But we also, at the same time, need to look at ourselves for the fact that we have babies in cages here in our own country. And that also needs to be abhorrent. We need to figure out a solution to our immigration policy in addition to our ag policies. But we really can't call out China on human rights violations when we're doing the exact same thing here. Maybe not to the same degree, but we need to be honest with ourselves that if we're going to treat our southern neighbors that way, that we need to make sure that we ask for accountability. Thank you.
Okay, Zach Racknerud, what are you hearing from farmers out there during your campaign?
Yeah, the biggest has to be the consolidation in the marketplace is probably one of the biggest issues out there, because when we have that much market share going to such few companies, that has rippling effects across the markets. And so Congress needs to take a look at its antitrust authority and really dig into this and find out exactly where we can make improvements to the bargaining power of our farmers. And when it comes to USMCA, there's wins in it, but at the same time, it's basically a carbon copy of NAFTA on the issue of ag.
That's absolutely not true.
On very many parts of it, a lot of it has to do with automobiles and whatnot. There's wins in dairy. There's wins in certain areas.
Grain grading to Canada.
Yes,
ethanol,
that's another.
Ethanol to Mexico. Things that are really important.
And that was actually that was pieced together because the Trump administration had put aluminum steel tariffs on Canada and Mexico, and USMCA patched that back up again. So I'm not going I'm not going to be giving credit to the administration for my party relentlessly. And Congressman Armstrong, that's basically what you've been doing as a representative of North Dakota, is cheerleading the President Trump's administration and not really ever taking a stand when it really matters. And so those are the big issues with our farmers, is really gaining back that market power and ensuring that they are getting a fair price for the incredible work that they're doing.
Okay, Kelly Armstrong, I know you want to respond.
Yeah. Well, I take a stand when it's important to North Dakota, but I think there's some things that need to be talked about. Waters of the United States went away under the Trump administration. USMCA, which was celebrated by every single farm group in North Dakota. And if you're talking about using antitrust, I'm doing it right now. I'm working with Republicans on the antitrust committee, dealing exactly with the four meatpackers in the middle of the process. It's never been done this way before.
There's agreement,
but DOJ has done their investigations. USDA has done their investigations. They take all of this stuff over to the Ag Committee. We've never ever solely focused on that. There's four bills introduced. Two of them are introduced by Republicans. Two of them are introduced by Democrats. And once we get through this antitrust hearing, which has actually been, I think Congress has actually acquitted themselves pretty well in that, we're working towards getting all four of these members, bipartisan, two on each side, to come in front of our committee, maybe even bring in the Wyoming Ag Commissioner and talk about some of the things they're doing there, because this is a crisis, and it's been a crisis for a long time. And I'll tell you all the same thing I tell every rancher that I talk to about this. I'm sorry it didn't happen sooner, but I've only been there for 2 years, and a lot of these conversations occurred before that, but we need to act on that. And that is just one of the simple supply chain issues, but it is a really high stressor right now.
Okay, last word on this, Stephen Peterson.
Well, I appreciate Zach giving Kelly a hard time about following the caucus forward. In times of challenge like this, you do follow leadership, and sometimes leadership gets it wrong. But we show consensus. We have to move forward with consensus. Now, we've already both discussed how Speaker of the House, Nancy Pelosi, someone that we're, whoever wins out of the three of us here, we're going to have to deal with her. Now, I do know that there was a discharge petition that was put into the House recently. It didn't pass, but the purpose behind that discharge petition was to remove her as Speaker of the House, because that would be the best thing to do for the United States, for the people of the United States. The political bias that's currently going on at the far reaches of the political parties, on the right and on the left, both need to work towards the center. We need to find consensus. Take care of the American people. Take care of American small business. Take care of the farmer. They'll take care of us.
Okay, let's move up to the farm bill now. Next farm bill, where does this stand? How will each of you, if elected, approach this issue? Kelly Armstrong, you start on this one.
Yeah, the farm bill, I'm very lucky for somebody who's not on the Ag Committee. Dusty Johnson from South Dakota is on it. Colin Peterson from Minnesota is on it. He's got a tough reelect, but regardless, those things working forward. You continue to support it. Crop insurance is, I mean, as we continue to deal with this, this is actually a conversation we probably all agree on if we were talking about hemp and crop insurance and some of those different things. But also supplemental crop insurance. I think we've seen more and more WIP plus, different issues in North Dakota. And you know what? Zach's right. When you do these supplemental payments and you go by acreage or go by, there's no line you're going to draw that isn't going to have winners and losers. Mm-hmm. We fought like heck to get canola included in the last program, and we fought every single day in my office, whether we were talking to Democrats, Republicans, USDA, and we couldn't get it into that final bill. So we'll continue to move on to those things, but whatever, the farm bill usually, it's always a tough fight because of SNAP and because of different things, but we get to the point where we end up supporting it and providing it because it's absolutely essential in North Dakota economy. Not just our farmers and ranchers, but every small town from one side of the state to the other.
Okay, Stephen Peterson, your turn.
The farm bill is always critical. As he just alluded to, SNAP and EBT are tied to our farm bills. And right now, especially with people suffering because of COVID-19, that's what's getting food to children that aren't able to attend schools. That's what's getting food to people that are living in this difficult time. And the farm bill, we're North Dakota, we're majority agriculture. We always have been, we always will be, even with the singularity coming. The difference is that we're going to be using mesh 5G networks to drive tractors across fields with GNSS location setting. But even with the technology that's coming, we still need to feed people. The farm bill is critical to make sure that all people in the United States are taken care of, at least to the minimum degree that we can. Taking care of our farmers is one of the most critical things that we can do in the United States. If we don't take care of our farmers and our ag community, then at that point, the rest of the country will fall apart. North Dakota, the Midwest, we feed the rest of this country, that which we don't import from other countries. So what we need to do is support our farmers. We need to support our North Dakotans. We need to find consensus on that, regardless.
Okay, Zach Racknerud.
So a couple things on the farm bill that are huge. The first one, Congressman Armstrong is right, we do have a lot of agreement on this one. It's the issue of hemp. And the differences that I would have in that representation is that I would be bold and aggressive to unlocking hemp as fast as we can. It is arcane to me that we have locked up this plant for so long just because it bears a resemblance to marijuana. Funny enough, this actually segues into climate change a bit. We have in our society today an addiction to single-use plastics. I'm just as guilty as anybody else. Hemp provides us a really adequate alternative to be able to create single-use products that don't take tens of thousands, if not longer, to degrade and continue to put CO2 into the atmosphere, which is having disastrous climate effects. And the second thing would be the USDA and the partnership with school lunches. I think this needs to be a permanent expansion to cover all student lunches. That is something that I feel very strongly about, is that the kids in our schools should not have to pay for school lunches.
My kids have no business taking federal money to pay for school lunches. Mine don't.
It should just be a baseline expectation in this country that when you go to school that you get fed. I'm sorry if there's some kind of entitlement difference there or something, but I don't have that difference. When kids go to school, they deserve to be fed. I don't care if their parent is a deadbeat. That kid should not suffer the consequences because of it. We can partner
Did
with
you
the
just
USDA.
Call me a deadbeat?
We can have partnership with the USDA, and we can make that universal school meal a reality, because that's
How
something that should
in North
happen.
How many Dakota did you just call a deadbeat, sir?
I'm not.
That's not fair.
I don't care if they're not feeding their kids or not doing that. That would be considered.
Or are we not discussing the current reality of what is happening here in this nation right now?
I'm sorry.
I know people that work real hard. They had good jobs, and you're now calling them a deadbeat
because of the economy. You're completely misconstruing.
I'm not
misconstruing.
I'm
yes,
taking
you are.
The word that you use.
My position on this is that every single school should have universal meals funded and paid for in advance. That's the point I was making.
Okay, we do need to move on to another question from our partners, AARP North Dakota. Social Security is a self-financed off-budget program that half of all seniors rely on for more than 50% of their income. If elected, how will each of you ensure that current and future Social Security benefits are not cut as part of deficit reduction? Stephen Peterson, you start on this issue.
This is difficult because we get into how Social Security was supposed to work, and then the unfunded mandates that were created in other jurisdictions, not necessarily here in North Dakota. But because of those unfunded mandates, we have people that now are afraid that their Social Security will go away. Now, that's just math. If you have what we call the boomer generation, without a number, those of us that are here on stage now, there's not enough of us to come along afterwards to pay for the coverages that they need. That's a fact. Now, how do we deal with that federally? I'm not exactly sure yet, but I do know that we need to make sure that those safety nets are there for all people so that somebody doesn't have a health problem later in their life or that they become disabled. We need that SSDI there for the safety net. We need the SSI there for the safety net for older people. And God forbid that that program gets discontinued and you call people deadbeats for any reason. I'm sorry that you said that. I'm trying not to take you to task personally, but think about the people you're speaking about. These are our neighbors. They don't deserve that. Not from you, not from me, not from him.
Okay, Zach Racknerud, your response?
So this is actually a really good example on the Social Security issue. Congressman Armstrong said that if the president does something that doesn't benefit North Dakota, that he will stand up and he will speak against it. The president recently put through a payroll tax cut that, number one, it only provides relief for those who are employed. So anybody who's unemployed during this crisis, it doesn't do anything. And he's made insinuations that he'll make this tax cut permanent on payroll. That would make Social Security insolvent by 2022. We're no longer talking about future generations of Social Security recipients. We're talking about the immediate future when it comes to this administration. That's where North Dakota's representative should actually hold them accountable and say that that is unacceptable. My stance on Social Security is that there is a taxable income cap set at $138,000, which means that every single working class person in this country and the bulk of middle class people are paying into Social Security on every single paycheck in the year, whereas those at the very top of the economy stop paying a single dime just minutes into the year. I believe that every single American should be paying into that every single check of the year, just like working people do. And with that new solvency, we can expand the program, we can modernize it, have it include maternity and paternity leave, make sure our seniors are better taken care of. It's common sense to me, and that's what I'll advocate for.
Okay, Kelly Armstrong.
The math on those things just simply doesn't work. But the reality with Social Security is just like everything else that happens in D.C., it gets politicized immediately, like exactly what just happened. The temporary thing that President Trump passed was, one, voluntary, and two, does not make Social Security insolvent in 2022. That is just simply not true. The problem with Social Security is you have two different groups of people, and I will just call them younger workers and older workers. And we are going to have, one of the reasons Social Security is insolvent is because we borrow against it, which we should stop doing. Another reason is because we are living longer and healthier lives, which is a fantastic thing. But we also have to start talking about people entering into the workforce, and if there are small minor tweaks we can do for the younger age population that ensures the solvency 40 years from now without turning into a political commercial run in every district in this country. If you say anything like that about they want to take away my grandmother's Social Security, that's not what anybody responsibly is talking about, but they're talking about a system that is exactly what he said. There are more people going into retirement. We will be able to take care of them, but how we resolve it in the future with the same retirement ages, longer lifespans, those are serious conversations that both sides in D.C. should get serious about.
Okay, I want to try to get to two more topics before we run out of time in this hour. Next topic, even though the death of George Floyd did not occur in North Dakota, a follow-up protest engulfed the nation, including a big one on a Saturday night here in Fargo. I want to ask each of you a response to the last few months of protests, social justice discussions, racial disparity discussions, and how each of you feel about police departments going forward. Zach Racknerud, you start on this one.
I joined many of the demonstrations that happened here in North Dakota, and the biggest takeaway I had from it was that there is a lot of pain out there when it comes to how criminal justice is applied in this country. I sympathize with it and I empathize with it. But at the same time, this conversation of defund the police is the completely backwards conversation that we need to be having right now. We need to be talking about better investments in law enforcement, such as better training, higher standards. That stuff is going to cost money. And with the COVID-19 pandemic in full swing, the state and local budgets that take care of those sorts of things are going to be hurting. Congress needs to be there to be an aid for our law enforcement community to be able to improve the standards and to also invest in other areas of life that would help lessen the need for the type of policing that we see and the injustices that we see. Things like ending the war on drugs and looking at the disastrous criminal justice legislations that we've passed in recent decades, we have to take a look at all of that and do better for Black North Dakotans, do better for the Native American community, and actually make progress that brings a more just system in this country.
Okay, Kelly Armstrong.
It's a pretty easy conversation for me. I've been actively engaged in it my entire adult life. I spent my first 10 years as a criminal defense attorney. I marshaled through the most significant criminal justice reform we've had in our history in North Dakota. And I've been front and center in every one of these conversations, whether it's with Karen Bass, Senator Tim Scott, or in the White House. We need to continue to move forward, but you have to recognize the simple reality on police reform. One, 99.9% of all law enforcement officers are great people doing a really tough job that every single time they get out of their vehicle, they run the risk of not getting back into it. None of us live in a profession like that. None of us get up every morning and go to work in a profession like that. And two, out of 2.3 million people incarcerated in this country, 2 million of them are incarcerated in state and local jails and prisons. Our state's attorneys are elected, our judges are elected, and our sheriffs are elected. Law enforcement is a local function. And I advocate in D.C. for really common sense reforms. De-escalation training is great across the board because it doesn't matter if you're dealing with a minority client, a female client, a young client, a mentally ill client. De-escalation training is good for everybody. But are any kind of police reform that we do out of D.C., one, needs to be paid for, and two, needs to work on the side of the road when you're measuring backup in hours and not minutes. And often what happens in that town is in their quest to solve whatever inner city problem they think they have, it is going to be an incredible burden on our local law enforcement and our local communities.
Okay, Stephen Peterson.
It's a difficult conversation to have. As he worked for 10 years in the criminal justice realm, I worked as a bail bondsman and a bail agent for roughly 20 years. We probably saw a lot of the same people over that time. Now, one of the key things that we have to look at are the sentencing guidelines that we have. Now, North Dakota has been aggressive under our current governor and with our current legislative members to be able to roll a lot of that back. Now, as far as how law enforcement treats people, I've captured and handcuffed over 1,000 people. I've never crushed any of them to death. I never had to shoot any of them to death or even have to shoot them to slow them down. I do believe that, yes, we can train our law enforcement better. And yes, they can also figure out how to de-escalate situations by making sure that we have health and human services programs available for these people before it accelerates to the point to where it becomes criminal. As a matter of fact, our entire drug war in this nation could be redirected into our clinics, into our hospitals. Yes, we have COVID right now. Yes, they're busy. But if we turn that into a medical issue, treat it as a medical emergency, how many of our resources can we take from our law enforcement agencies off of the drug war, put it into helping people with diversion programs? We have good programs here in North Dakota. I watched a gentleman get released through the BTC not even a little over a year ago. He's now a general manager in your district at a restaurant. He's proven himself to be worthy of our attention, yet he still served time in our prison. Our goal is to get the right outcome. Sometimes bad things happen. Sometimes people who are looking for mental health help end up losing it and shooting an officer here in Fargo. We failed that officer by not having mental health services available for that individual here in Fargo. And sadly, we lost more than one person.
Okay, I want to get Zach Racknerud in for about a 30-second response as we kind of move toward closing statements.
So I want to say to Stephen, I agree and appreciate a lot of what he said. Those investments in the other areas of life that really impact the crime rates themselves, they really do. And that if we don't make those investments, we're going to continue to see economic anxieties and mental health care issues that continue to erode, and we need to attack those aggressively. So thank you. The other thing I would say just real quick is what's so important to North Dakota is that we get the Violence Against Women Act passed. Congressman Armstrong did vote against it, and in fairness to him, it was because he didn't agree with certain parts of it. But even if that's the case, it's so important to communities here in North Dakota that you need to be putting pressure on Senate colleagues to hammer out what you didn't like about it, send it back, get rid of those things that you didn't like, and get it passed, because people in this state feel betrayed with that legislation not getting passed, and we need to get it done as soon as possible.
Okay, Kelly Armstrong.
Well, and first, we offered a clean extension of the Violence Against Women's Act, the same one that existed before. And secondly, it wasn't a minor change. It was about double jeopardy on a Native American reservation, something I know a little bit about. My firm took that case to the United States Supreme Court, not the least of which is really important in North Dakota, and I'm going to get to a couple things here, is that they took away all religious exemptions for anything that qualifies in that. I'm not making judgments on who does this work or who doesn't, but I am just telling you that if a Catholic church in our community is doing this work and they're the only ones available, which oftentimes they are, they should get their religious exemptions, because perfect is the enemy of good. And my grandmother was the head of North Dakota Mental Health for 20 years, and I've spent a lot of time in courtrooms with people who had addiction and mental illness. But just throwing resources at this is simply not the problem. And in fact, we have to get creative, because here's the dirty little secret. There aren't enough people in college to fill those positions that are available all across the country. And if you can't fill them in New York City or Chicago, Illinois, it's going to be very difficult to get them to come to Watford City or Standing Rock. So we have to think about how we do this. We have to target it. But do you know how you target it? You get flexible grant funding to states and let them deal with it with the problems they have on the ground. And a one size fits all federal solution will absolutely be devastating.
Okay, last word on this, Stephen Peterson.
I have to agree with Kelly regarding that. I'm not saying that we just throw services at people. What I am saying, though, is that we need to make the availability, the accessibility of services more available to people. That's what I'm seeking. And I don't see you having a problem.
No, I think everybody agrees with that.
And as far as us developing future law enforcement, the community programs that we've had in the past under different police chiefs and sheriffs across this state, we've had good communities. We've had times. I'm not saying that it was perfect, but I am saying that we've had times here in North Dakota where people do get along with each other. We need to focus on community policing and make sure that those people do come from our communities when we do policing. That way they understand the social economic issues that we have.
Okay. That we and our final topic,
thank you,
because we're getting close to time. Last topic from AARP North Dakota: Americans pay the highest drug prices in the world. If elected, how will you cut prescription drug prices for Americans? Stephen Peterson, 1 minute.
Oh man, that's tough. When I was living down in Mexico City, I ran out of my medications, and it cost me less than $15 to recoup what I needed while I was there. If I was here in the United States, I would have had insurance cover it, and that would have been over $300. My brother is a diabetic. I really do want us to find more ways to make that so that his children at least have some type of a legacy moving forward, and not all their money goes towards his medications. I do believe maybe fair is not the proper word there, but we can do better for our people here in the United States. We just need to move some things around. And I understand that corporations deserve to get the money back for the developments that they've done. However, yes, we need to fast track products as we can. The discussion of governance, let me finish.
That's
real
okay.
Quick.
Yeah, go ahead.
The discussion of governance and taxation and costs always become a huge pain for all of us on both sides, because then we're dictating and mandating to those companies what they can do with their funds. And that I have a problem with.
Okay, Zach Racknerd.
So with the issue of prescription drugs, number one, reimportation has got to be a focus, because other developed economies negotiate their drug prices. And in the short term, if we get reimportation completed, we could lower drug prices and actually access those lower prices and help so many millions of Americans. At the same time, we need to start the process of allowing the Secretary of Health and Human Services and those in the programs of Medicare and Medicaid to negotiate for the drug prices. That's a big difference between Congressman Armstrong and I, is he believes that stifles innovation. I don't. I think that negotiation is a healthy process where we figure out how much of your research was funded by the taxpayer, how much did you spend, what do you need to sell this for in order to make a margin, because obviously that innovation and stuff is important, but at the same time, we cannot be living in a nation where Americans are paying 10 times the price for the exact same prescription drugs as literally 100 miles north of here. It's unacceptable and we need to fix it.
Okay, last word on this, Kelly Armstrong.
First of all, the negotiation that was actually in the Democrats' bill wasn't a negotiation, because if you ended it at a year, then the government just got to set the price. And so that's not a negotiation. Anybody who's ever participated in one knows that that's simply not how it works. That being said, we should quit subsidizing other countries' drug pricing. But the two things we can do now, this has been going on for a long time. I have talked to the AARP. Hi, Josh, if you're watching. We've had these conversations for a long time, and it's been this big conversation about what we do. Well, you know what? The American people are sick of it. Here's what you do. You get transparency in pricing, and you get to patent reform, because I think you could get significant bipartisan neither one of those is a silver bullet, but sometimes the first step is the hardest. And in this divided Congress and the way things are working and the way as toxic as that environment is, you go get significant patent reform. They deserve exclusivity if they develop a drug that is saving hundreds and hundreds of thousands of lives, but that exclusivity shouldn't be gamed at the back end on the patent system. And the real problem in pharmaceutical pharmaceutical pricing from one end of the spectrum to the other, whether it's private insurance, Medicare, Medicaid, is transparency in pricing. Nobody pays list price. It goes into the middle, but they essentially create an arms race, because if you don't get a big enough discount and you don't get a big enough coupon, then insurance companies and pharmaceutical companies won't sell it. So transparency in pricing.
I do need to get to closing statements. Kelly Armstrong, you go first.
Yeah, so thanks for having us. Everybody, thanks for being here. I think the national politic could learn a little bit about this. We treat each other fairly, but we'll interject and do those things in a lot of time. And I just appreciate the opportunity to do this. Listen, outside of getting married and having my two kids, serving North Dakota has been the single biggest pleasure I've ever had in my entire life. I think I've done it well. When the time calls to fight, I fight. When the time calls to be in the room, I'm in the room. But at the same time, I will work with anybody on any side of the aisle to continue to move the issues forward for North Dakota, because the reality is North Dakota is not a sleepy little flyover country. We are an agricultural powerhouse. We're an energy powerhouse. We're a tech powerhouse. And we are forced to be reckoned with, and that's how I advocate in Washington, D.C. Thanks. Vote for Armstrong on November 3rd.
Okay, Stephen Peterson, closing statement.
I really appreciate Prairie Public for having me here today. I appreciate the AARP for helping again with this. I just want to make sure that the people of North Dakota get a proper chance to examine the options that they have here. I don't have a problem with some of the things that Zach said. I definitely don't have a problem with some of the things that Congressman Armstrong said. What really matters, though, is that whoever we send, whether that be me or one of these two fine gentlemen, their goal needs to be consensus building when they get to Washington, because that's how we're going to move agendas forward. And consensus means bringing both aisles, across the aisles, together. And I realize that we have some people on the far extremes of each party that are causing dilemmas right now. We need to work towards the center to be able to move America forward. So regardless of who you elect out of North Dakota for this, please make sure that you do your best choice.
Okay, Zach Racknerud, closing statement.
Thank you, Prairie Public, and thank you, AARP, for hosting us. I just want to say that I entered this race back in January, and that was before the coronavirus pandemic. I understand the economic pain that existed out there before coronavirus, and how the bottom lines of our working families have been strained for some time now. We need significant investments in healthcare. We need significant investments in education, in childcare, in housing. These sorts of things where the market alone is falling short. Congress has the opportunity to make investments in these things. The coronavirus pandemic has just shown exactly how urgently it's needed. And I'm gonna be that champion for working people in the US House, because I am a working person. I am working class my whole life. I understand what it's like to live paycheck to paycheck, what it's like to grow up in a family with crushing medical debt and also having to live paycheck to paycheck. These things are unacceptable in the wealthiest nation that the earth has ever seen. And I humbly ask that you consider supporting this campaign. Thank you.
Thank you all for being here. Thanks to our sponsor, AARP North Dakota, and thanks for you for watching Prairie Public's continuing coverage of Election 2020. Good night.
Funding for Election 2020 coverage is provided in part by AARP, a nonprofit, nonpartisan membership association, 86,000 strong in North Dakota. AARP encourages you to vote absentee or vote safely in person and make your voice heard. And by the members of Prairie Public.